One of the highlights of the president's speech is him saying that he will be protecting our maritime coverages. The UNCLOS has clarified limits and coverages of maritime zones. The 2016 arbitral ruling has also been mentioned by the president, and he quoted, "I do not intend to yield. Filipinos do not yield." With the president mentioning this on an international level, what do you think this message sends to a lot of our peers in the region?
Well, sending the fact that we are ready to defend what we believe is ours, it's also a message to the Filipino nation that we have a president who is, of course, willing to basically take, you know, basically focus all his attention in ensuring that every Filipino would have, of course, enjoy the richness and the resources of our exclusive economic zone. Of course, this is the very essence of what we call the comprehensive archipelagic defense concept, which of course the president also mentioned in the latter part of his speech. But this is a point mentioned by the president. At the start of his speech, he basically talked about the evolution of the Philippines as archipelagic nation. Then the fact this archipelagic nation is already a middle power and expect this middle power to play a very important role, primarily because of what's happening in our maritime domain, and more significantly, what's happening in the Indo-Pacific region.
I'm actually curious, Professor, about what China might be thinking during the time that the president's already giving his speech, because this is an international community, and the Philippines is making a stand, actually claiming that our exclusive economic zone is ours, and China, everybody knows, is doing a lot of aggressive actions to try to overtake what is ours. Now, what do you think this will do if for the international community, if they see that China is once again still continuing their bullying for different waters in the country, in the region as well?
Well, the Chinese foreign minister already made a statement, right? It accuses the Philippines, without mentioning the Philippines, of hyping up the South China Sea issue. And of course, using international law and the United Nations Convention of the Law of the Sea to weaponize its efforts, of course, to hype the South China Sea issue. So we're already getting the reaction from China. And I think this is the primary purpose of the president. But although we have to give credit for the president for his sophistication and subtlety, never in his speech did he mention China. Right? But everyone in the room, and of course, the international audience, is aware of the fact that he's referring to that elephant in the room, which everyone knows happened to be China, or I would say the dragon in the room. And now we're, of course, having the reaction from China, from the Chinese foreign ministry.
Now, let's look at the other thing that the president has mentioned, the growing tensions between the China and the U.S. It's according to him, it's exacerbating flashpoints and creating new security dilemma. Now, on the sidelines of the summit, the U.S. and the Chinese defense ministers already met, and they've criticized each other's actions. How will their statements affect the Philippines? Professor, what do you think?
Well, the statement is primarily directed to the ASEAN countries and, of course, to our people that, you know, it is a nuanced approach regarding the strategic competition. The majority of the ASEAN member states do not want to get involved in the strategic competition. They try to basically, you know, want to remove themselves from this strategic competition. In his speech, the president basically emphasized the fact that the strategic competition is here. It's happening with our mid. It's forcing countries to basically make choices. But on the other hand, he basically states we have to look at the strategic competition head on. So we have to, in a way, we could have to look at it both as a challenge and also in a way an opportunity. So his actions, like for example, stating the importance of our alliance with the United States, the importance of the security partnerships we have with Japan, Australia, and of course India, and of course his mention of the trilateral summit among the Philippines, Japan, and of course the United States, in a way it's also telling us that we have to accept the strategic competition between China and the United States as given, and we will also have to use it as an opportunity to basically enhance our interests, our interest in maintaining, of course, asserting our maritime entitlement in the South China Sea. And more significantly, a point raised by the president, the Philippines is part of the rules-based international order, and it's not in our interest to see this rules-based international order being revised or changed.
Mm-hmm. Well, speaking of national interests, we do know that politics is that kind of a game, you know, advancing our own national interests. This actually evoked the president to saying that he's rejecting the idea of making a choice between U.S. and China. What do you think is the best course of action for the country?
Well, the best course of action, of course, early on in his term, President Marcos emphasized the need of a balanced relation between China and the United States. Mm-hmm. Do you remember his second State of the Nation address? He said, I would like to have a good economic relations with China, but at the same time, one that's balanced with our alliance with the United States. Mm-hmm. So I think his speech, in a way, is also a reiteration of his approach that, you know, it is a given that you have the U.S.-China strategic competition, but as much as possible, if we have the, you know, if it's an optimum choice on our part, we don't want to make a choice. Rather, we have to use the strategic competition to our advantage.
Mm-hmm. All right. Finally, Professor, before I let you go, because it's a weekend and you, of course, have a lot to do as well, are there any other issues that you wish the president might have spoken about during his keynote speech?
Well, I will mention a issue that he mentioned, and I think this, again, would tickle the raw nerves of China.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to credit the president for his courage regarding this. Mm-hmm. When he mentioned Taiwan, the mm-hmm. Taiwan Straits,
mm-hmm.
of course, from the Chinese perspective, this is an internal matter. You know, no countries have the right to basically talk about the Taiwan Strait issue because, again, from the position of China, Taiwan is simply a province of mm-hmm. China. And whatever China would do against Taiwan is an internal matter.
Mm-hmm.
The president mentioned Taiwan mm-hmm. and emphasized the importance of stability mm-hmm. in the Taiwan Strait, emphasizing the fact that although we have a one-China policy, it is in the interest of the Philippines that peace and stability is, of course, maintained in the Taiwan Strait. And interestingly, he also made a very subtle, pointed criticism of China mm-hmm. in that part of his speech when he mentioned countries involved in this issue have to exercise restraint.
Mm-hmm.
We have to understand this. Just last week, China launched a massive military exercises around Taiwan.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a very subtle, pointed criticism of Chinese action when it comes to the Taiwan issue.
Mm-hmm. And it's a very delicate matter because we still do believe in the one China policy, Professor. But if you'd let me get in one more question before I let you go.
Okay. Uh-huh. Let me emphasize this point.
Go ahead.
Although we adhere to the one China policy, we have interest in the peace and stability mm-hmm. of Taiwan. And the president mentioned it.
Mm-hmm.
Number one, it's not only the stability there, but the fact that we have 200,000 Filipinos working in Taiwan. What will ever have happened to cross-strait relations would affect our vital interests. That is mm-hmm. 200,000 Filipino workers in
mm-hmm.
Taiwan.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. All right, one more question, Professor, while I still have you, because this is the first time that a Philippine leader has been able to speak in this kind of international platform. I was wondering, how would you be able to compare the previous administration's foreign policy to President Marcos's policy now when we look at the furtherance of the Philippines on political matters in the international stage?
Well, I will put the period, let's say, at the second decade of the 21st century, where, of course, this is a term that President Marcos have mentioned several times, geopolitics.
Mm-hmm.
When, of course, you have geopolitical dynamics being generated by, of course, China's expansive claim in the South China Sea, which began around 2012, when, of course, China took control of Scarborough Shoal. So the late President Benigno Aquino III did not have that opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
Then, of course, the former president who simply appeased China could not be given that opportunity. We have a president here who started with a very dynamic effort to find the balance between China and the United States,
mm-hmm.
but now has basically taken an active stance in asserting our, of course, maritime interests in the South China Sea, being, of course, a very important player in Indo-Pacific geopolitics, and, of course, adopting a grand strategy for the Philippines in the 21st century, making that speech in the Shangri-La Dial. We have to credit the Philippines for his geostrategic, geopolitical insights and ability, of course, to ensure that the Philippines will play a very active role in the Indo-Pacific region.
All right. With that, I'll let you go. Thank you for your time this weekend, Professor. You have a good afternoon ahead of you.
Thank you very much. And again, have a great weekend to you and to our people, to our viewers.
Thank you. That's Professor Renato De Castro joining us.